pleasant good morning, and we say welcome to you as we go into another episode of Pastor's Corner. It is indeed a beautiful day. God is with us, and this is a day that we know that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And friends of mine, those from the community or viewing audience, we are so glad that you have joined us so that we can grow spiritually in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we can have a better understanding of what the Word of God says and the various issues that surround us as Christians. And so this morning, I have with me a distinguished man of God. He is the president of the Grenada Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. But before I tell you his name, shall we bow our heads for prayer? Loving Father and God, we thank you this morning for bringing us here. Thank you for your many blessings and even for grace. We pray as we go into Pastor's Corner and we open the way for discussion, we ask for an illumination of mind, wisdom, so that we can speak accordingly, so that heaven would be pleased with what is said. The discussion ensued, and may individuals be blessed by the discussion today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, for those who just joining us, we say welcome to you. I am your host, Pastor Bernard Lyons, and with me, I have the president of the Grenada Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, Pastor Enoch Isaac, and so I'm going to ask him to share some greetings with you from the desk of the president, and then we are going to go into our topic for today.
Thank you, Pastor Lyons, and a pleasant good morning to all the family of Pastor's Corner. We are excited that you already joined us, and some of you are in the process of doing that. But we are happy that you are here, and I'm happy to be with you. It seems to me as though it was a year ago since I sat in Pastor's Corner. It's been a couple months, but it just seems a very long time. But I'm happy to be here again to share with you this morning in Pastor's Corner. And we look forward for a very engaging experience today. God bless you. Enjoy.
All right. Thank you very much, Mr. President. And we also have our regular friends with us online. And this online family is so dedicated that you can almost tell who is going to be on once the program begins. And so we have Eulene, Alexander, Anita Johnson, Alicia, Stephen, Rawl Ferguson. We have Elisa, Batiste Simon. We have Donna Beckon. We have Leon Sweetness. And so we say welcome to you at this time. And ensure that you invite a friend, a family member. Let them know that we are discussing unequally yoke today. And I know it is a topic that often brings a sense of irritation to some individuals. But today we want to provide awareness so that we are scratching where it is itching. And so let us go into our discussion as we ask God's blessings as we move in Jesus' name. Our first question this morning, we have our dear Pastor Isaac with us. Our first question, Paul speaks of unequally yoked. What is the meaning of this phrase in the contemporary language? And allow me to read a passage of scripture that comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 6. And allow me verses 14 on to verse 18. It says, "Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Baal? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols. For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. Verse 18 says, I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. So these are some very powerful words coming from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 on to verse 18. And we're speaking about being unequally yoked. And so the question being posed at this time and reiterated, Paul speaks of unequally yoked. What is the meaning of this phrase in contemporary language?
Well, thank you, Pastor Lyons. I notice also that Pastor Boeing have joined us. to respond, I'm not sure that there's a different meaning that was meant by Paul than today in contemporary language. The Apostle Paul, as the text you read, clearly indicate that there should be no bonding of believers with unbelievers. The Apostle Paul didn't specify in what areas. You know, very often we talk about or we hear unequally yoked, and immediately our minds go to relationship-wise. You know, it's almost natural. Unequally yoked relationship. Who's marrying who? You know, but the Apostle Paul didn't mention anything about that. He just mentioned a believer should not be yoked. That to yoke means to be bound together. Now we read in the scriptures, we don't have that practice here where we have plows, we are very mechanized or farming. But in the scriptures and in Bible times, in that agrarian society, the oxen and would plow. Yes. And it was very very often they would have two oxen. You know, I don't know of a situation where they have one oxen. And for reason being, well, number one is the animal hauling the plowing machine, I call it a machine or the apparatus. And therefore, for strength, you imagine, and so they would very often yoke two oxen together. Now, if the yoking of the oxen is not proper, the apparatus would not function well because they're unequally yoked. They're not properly tied together. They're not properly harnessed together, and therefore the functioning of the apparatus would not properly be able to plow till the soil. So that's the language the Apostle Paul used, and the readers and listeners there would fully understand what he meant, because they are accustomed to yoking oxen. And if it's not equally yoked, if it's not properly done, then they know they would not have the effectiveness of the plowing machine.
What about a donkey and an ox? Would you yoke a donkey and an ox?
Well, that's interesting. I don't think that would be the case, because very often, now the oxen would be, and if it is that you have a donkey, well, we assume that you'll have another donkey, because the two animals, they may have similarities, but they're different, a donkey and an ox. So you may find the animals will be agitated, maybe. Because a donkey, you're yoked together, you're right there, you're not very far away, because you have to be harnessed together. And to me, that donkey will feel very uncomfortable. It's not so close. It's not meant to be so close to the next animal. Or if it is that it's close, the donkey should be able to move away. But when it's yoked, it can't move away. So what would happen instead of plowing, because the role is to plow. And to me, if the donkey is yoked with an ox or some other animal, that is contention. They will be contending rather than working together to plow the soil. So the Apostle Paul used this analogy, which was quite clear in the minds of the believers. Believers should not be yoked together with unbelievers in whatever aspect. So he didn't specify that it's marriage or it's business or it's Christian missionary work. No, he didn't specify. He just laid it down what a believer does, how a believer functions, if the believer should be yoked together. And he didn't say sit side by side. He used the term yoke because, as I said, yoke is a bonding. You can't get away. You are yoked. The animals that are yoked can't get away like that. You see? And if you are yoked together for purposes that marriage, relationship-wise or otherwise, then that will be very contentious. And that will be counterproductive to what that you intended to achieve in the first place. Okay. Yeah, so I'm just saying my initial statements would be it doesn't matter if it's contemporary or going back to biblical times. It would apply across the board, really.
Remains the same. All right, as we move on, we go to our second question. It's undoubted that the concept of compatibility is being highlighted. How important is it when contemplating marriage? So we're speaking about compatibility, the concept of compatibility. So we believe it is being highlighted here. Of course, you mentioned he doesn't specify exactly what area. It is almost like a blanket statement. It is more like a principle being applied. And so we work with the principle under the various circumstances that we may find ourselves in. All right, we say welcome to Pastor Dwight Bowen. All right, let's just make sure that you have voice so that the people can hear you. All right, you're getting there in Jesus' name. All right, so you will get there in Jesus' name. So we get in there. All right, let me hear you, Pastor Bowen.
Mm-hmm. Well, the question, you're dealing with the question now, right?
Go ahead.
All right. excuse me. We have to understand what is the meaning of compatibility. Mm-hmm. If we set that platform, then we can move forward. Compatibility in marriage is a degree of similarity and harmony between partners.
Okay.
And there are different various types of compatibility or aspects.
Mm-hmm.
We have physical compatibility, which deals with the physical attraction you have to a particular individual.
Mm-hmm.
You have the emotional compatibility, which deals with the degree of emotional connection between you and the individual. When you see that individual, like when Adam saw Eve, something in Adam, in Eve drives something in Adam. And Adam say, bone of flesh of my flesh. There is a mental compatibility, which refer to intellectual link between individuals. How will they keep that conversation, that level of conversation which they keep and so on, mental capability. Also, spiritual compatibility, which deals with shared vision and values and so on. So this is the basis for compatibility in those aspects. These are just a few. There are social compatibility, which refers to the degree of alignment between individuals in terms of similar interests and values. Mm-hmm. And we deal with that too. And in the context of our discussion this morning, when you're choosing a life partner, these things must be important. You can't choose somebody who you're not connected to, someone you cannot discuss matters with, someone who take offense over everything. They're not interested in certain things that you are interested in, then it's going to create some problems. So we have to look at that as well. As well as spiritual compatibility. Did the person believe the same thing as you? Are we hoping for the same thing in the future? We believe in Jesus, yes. But do you believe in certain doctrines and so? Is there a mutual connection in those things? Yes.
Okay. But what about marriage? What about marriage? We speak about marriage. You said marriage. When it comes to marriage, that is important. But what is marriage, by the way? What is marriage? When you say marriage, when you speak about marriage, what are you speaking about?
And we're speaking about the joining of two individuals together. By God, the sanction for, you know, raising a family and various things like that. When you speak about marriage, putting two persons together, joining them together in holy matrimony.
Yeah. All right, and what about as it pertains to, you say two individuals, but we're speaking about unequally yoked.
Okay.
Right? So, in God's design, what is the ideal for marriage? Let's set the right basis.
Well, of course, let me just jump in here, Pastor, as you asked the question. I think Pastor Boeing speaks with the understanding, you know. 20 years ago, if Pastor Boeing said that, maybe not even 20 years ago, maybe 10 years ago, if he said that, it is generally understood.
Sorry.
But now it is not so. So we have to be very clear. Marriage is the joining of, as far as God is concerned, as far as Christians are concerned, Bible-believing Christians are concerned, two persons, one male and one female.
All right, very
right?
Nice.
The joining of them in what we call holy matrimony, in that unity aspect. So yes, compatibility. I must say though that sometimes we use the term to be one of the same, unequally yoked compatibility. But no, they're not the same. Because they're the same in a minuscule instance, but in the general scheme of things, they're different. Because two persons can be correctly equally yoked, but yet still incompatible.
Okay. Break that down for us, Pastor.
Yes. So you have a male, you have a female.
Okay.
They're Christians.
Okay.
They're Seventh-day Adventist Christians.
Okay.
They're believers. Mm-hmm. So they are equally yoked. Mm-hmm. Yes, they're equally yoked. But they're not compatible. Pastor shared quite a few areas of compatibility. Mm-hmm. Social compatibility, spiritual compatibility. But they're not compatible. And that compatibility can relate to the social aspect of things. They're just on different wavelengths. And it matters not how sometimes people talk about, you know, Pastor, don't watch that. We love each other. No. It will show up. Mm-hmm. It's going to be problematic. Notwithstanding, sometimes we just put a blanket. Love. We just throw love outside there. You know, love covers the multitude of sin. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe so, relative to Christ and salvation. But when it comes to relationship, you do with human beings. And if we ignore certain things, it's going to be, Pastor Lance, problematic. There's no way you can get around it because we are human beings. Okay. You see? So there are some things that we persons must give attention to. And sometimes people will say, we are big people. We understand each other. So we are watching that. You know? Well, you may not watch that, but that thing you're not watching is watching you.
Okay.
And it will come back because when it's time to discuss and to you'll find yourself very irritated because you find this is a very simple thing. And honey, I'm saying this to you, but the person is not getting it because the compatibility probably on the level of reasoning and education. It doesn't mean it doesn't mean that someone has a PhD. I think there's a question on that. Mm-hmm. That someone has a PhD and someone does not have a first degree, it doesn't mean that the person doesn't, because you can be well-read without actually formalizing going to school. So I'm not suggesting. In fact, there are persons who have not gone to doesn't possess a college degree, and their reasoning is quite superior to persons who have paper, who have degrees in their hand. So I'm not referring to that. I'm just talking about someone who has not. It's not properly read. And therefore, the level of discussion, and understanding and matters will be so far apart that you'll have one partner very agitated, by the slightest thing because of the level of incompatibility that exists in the relationship.
Okay. And what about your marriage officer? of the state and you do counseling, what about baggage of the past? Can that cause individuals to be unequally yoked? Baggage of the past? You're coming with hurt, you're coming in a relationship with pain. Is that part of being unequally yoked? Is there a psychological aspect to being unequally yoked?
I would say no, not really, but it has to be taken consideration. That's the point I'm making. We cannot dump everything on unequally yoked.
Okay.
You know, but it's something to be taken consideration.
All right.
Because if it is, it would be saying once one has that for the past, there can't be. And I know that's not proper. That's not correct.
Okay.
But it has to be considered, because if it's not considered, if it's not taken into the mix of things, then then it's going to be problematic. Mm-hmm. So you can have someone, two people, and they think in a relationship, and one has a, you call it baggage, or we all have baggages anyway,
mm-hmm.
but there are some pronounced baggages, put it that way. And there's nothing sinful about it. It's just that there's some issues. Now,
okay.
That person could marry someone else
mm-hmm.
and live a very happy, satisfied life, because that other person may have had a similar experience,
okay.
and they can relate better.
Okay.
So the issues that the baggage, that we what we call baggage,
mm-hmm.
is not so much baggage, because the other person
mm-hmm.
has some similar issues and can relate to it, rather than if it was someone else, if you understand what I'm saying. So
okay.
the issues that one have, is who better can relate to it, because
okay.
you can relate here, you can, that person can relate to it to that other person, because that other person has a similar experience
okay.
and they can live very satisfied, fulfilling lives. While on the other hand, if they had gone a next way, it was problematic, because that person, there's no understanding of the issues involved there.
Okay.
So it's not necessarily unequally yoked,
mm-hmm.
but there are issues which should be considered and shouldn't just be brushed aside.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Our third question. Does the idea of unequally yoked extend beyond marriage? For example, should an Adventist entrepreneur yoke with an uncovered partner?
I think you really wanted to ask unconverted. Yeah.
To develop a business enterprise. So let's walk it again and ask the question again. As we speak about unequally yoked, the question is, does it extend beyond marriage? And so should we have a believer being involved with an unbeliever in a business enterprise?
Okay. Now, first of all, Pastor Lyons, if I should speak first.
Okay.
Of course, when Paul made that statement there, it's a different context and dynamics.
Mm-hmm.
It was Christian or believer versus an unbeliever or an infidel. You don't believe it. Because there wasn't what we have now. No, it's denomination and religion, if you know what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
So Paul wasn't speaking about a Seventh Adventist versus a Pentecostal. That didn't exist. It was, you're a believer in Christ, and the others believe in Baal and all the other, sun gods and moon gods and all the other gods. So either you're a believer
yeah.
or a non-believer.
Okay.
Like the Quran spell it out very well. You're a believer or you're an infidel. You're a non-believer. You don't believe. Yes? So that's all the context in which Paul said, of course, but we have to, because some folks would say, yeah, of course, Paul never talked about Adventists not being in business with a non-Adventist. Of course not. But the principle is what he said.
Okay.
You see? So you're asking the question, if it goes beyond marriage. Of course, as I said, because in the first place, it's not meant to be only marriage in the first place. You see, we interpret it to mean that. But Paul never meant it to be in relation to marriage.
Okay.
Yes, he meant to be in every situation where believers are yoked.
Okay.
And I suppose it naturally comes to mind when you think of yoke, because wedding, you say you're getting married, you're getting yoked, you're getting tied.
Yeah.
You know, so that's a natural example that comes first. But Paul never meant it to be that or that only. So it relates to every other situation. And when you're yoked, your business practices, as a Christian, as a believer, Seventh Adventist believer, put it that way, there could be a number of business practices that you hold very high standard, your ethical standard. There are some people in business have no ethical standard. They're in business to make money, and they will do anything to make money because it's about money. Yeah. As a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, God expects you to have high ethical standards. Even before we get to the point of Sabbath, the business opening on Sabbath. I mean, that's an issue because it could be a good, serious-minded Pentecostal, but they don't hold the same belief as you relative to God's Sabbath. Sabbath Saturday is another day, and Saturday is another very good business day for them. Mm-hmm. And that's the day you don't want to open your business. Well, you know, for other persons, to make money. The Seventh-day Adventist can't. You can't be worshiping God on His holy day, and you can't say, "Well, it's not me, my part. I am in church and I'm keeping God's Sabbath day holy, and my partner is running the business." You have a signal part to play in the business. It's not like you. I know some folks would ask, and some folks have asked before. Well, Pastor, I have shares in Green Lake. You have a couple $1,000 shares in Green Lake, and Green Lake is open on Saturday. I just use Green Lake. You're not in charge of Green Lake. You are a shareholder with a few, you're not the majority. Mm-hmm. Currently, the government of Green Lake holds majority shareholder there in Green Lake. Okay. So I'm making a point. It's different than you invest. It's different where you invest in a company and you have a few shares. Now, when you're sole proprietor, of course, you're in charge. Or when you have a business with an entrepreneur, two entrepreneurs, partnership, you have equal shares. So if you say close on Sabbath, it has to close because you have that power, right? So when you're worshiping God and that business is running, and monies have been made, and you feel very comfortable sitting in church praising God. No, you're not praising God. You're not praising God. You are not praising God. You are there being hypocritical about what is religion. So you just go to church. You go to church and you sit there, but you're not praising God because you cannot praise God while you have a business breaking the Sabbath. You cannot praise God and your bus. You have a bus and it's running, and you have your paying driver to run bus, and you're praising God. No, you can't praise God that way. That is different. I repeat myself. That is different from you have a few shares in Flow, and Flow. You're not in charge of Flow. You're not in charge of Flow, right? So you purchase some shares, and $1,000 share, $5,000. I don't know. You have some shares. You're very minuscule. You're not very important to the operation. You want to rejoice your shares. You rejoice your shares, and Flow will run. Mm-hmm. That is different from owning a business with a partner and the business is running. Mm-hmm. You are equally yoked. You're yoked together. Your principles vary. Mm-hmm. It differs widely. Mm-hmm. And you think of praising God. You're not praising God.
All right, Pastor Bowen, what's your thought on the matter?
Well, I share the same sentiment with Pastor. But what motivates a Christian to open a business? And what motivates an unbeliever to open a business? Let me just share this with us, as alluding to what Pastor said. Because faith transforms a person's character, Christian motivation, objective, and approaches are incompatible with those of an unbeliever. The primary aspiration of a Christian is to exalt Jesus and to seek to gratify Him in all aspects of life. Whereas an individual who does not adhere to the Christian faith typically display a sense of apathy or disinterest. For example, Pastor said, an unbeliever will try to trick the system. But you as a Christian, you're not up to that. Mm-hmm. So should you go with a person who is a trickster in order to raise your profit and do the wrong thing? So I think it's important for us to understand that. And the Bible said that. The Bible said, fellowship. What fellowship we have with people of darkness. And to have fellowship, to be in fellowship with somebody, is what? To come together to a mutual agreement. For example, if we're in fellowship in a setting, all of us, our minds, everything is one place. Mm-hmm. And so we have to be careful with that. Having fellowship with light and darkness, and that can lead us detrimental to a Christian.
Okay. Well, of course, as a business individual, mm-hmm. Mr. President, there are businesses that provide a service. You just provide a service. But generally speaking, a business, you enter into a business to make money, to make a profit. So I'm seeing, as a Christian, your ideals are high, but once you enter a business, you're not entering a business just to, you're not just giving away bakes free. Mm-hmm. You're there to make a profit. Correct. So that must be part and parcel of the process. Mm-hmm. So the Christian wants to make a profit, and the Adventist should want to make a profit too. Mm-hmm. With the understanding that the morals and ethics, they should be held high, representing Christ in whatever we do. Because I don't want persons to live with the understanding and think that they should enter a business and exalt Christ and don't make a profit.
Well, I'm not sure. I'm not sure what business is that. I think that is clear. But just in case that someone got it miscued, mm-hmm. Yeah. If you're a business person, I mean, look at the Bible. Person who's given the talent, that's the parable of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Went and buried, no profit. What did Jesus say? Jesus didn't elevate that person. That was not acceptable. If you knew you weren't going to invest to make a profit, you should have given it to the exchanger, says Jesus.
Okay.
Yeah? Yeah, so the Christian entering a business, obviously, because you can't sustain yourself.
Good.
The business can't. So, profiteering is important, but of course, ethics comes in, because if your only drive is profit, you will do very unchristian things.
Okay.
Because you're going, it's profit galore. Mm-hmm. You will shortchange your workers. Mm-hmm. You should give them the basic, not less than the basic, and you give them less than that. I'm talking about the government is now trying to institute raise the basic wage. Okay. And I'm saying that person, when you're so profit driven that you're trying to squeeze, not even giving the workers what is due to them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And a number of other practices. So we're not saying at all that you're going to a business not to make profit. Business, any good business person, God expects you to be utilize your talents well. Mm-hmm. Get involved. If you're selling mangoes, that's a business. Yeah, in order to buy mangoes, mm-hmm. you have a batch of mangoes, you need to sell that, make enough money. Because it's a business. You have to get again because the mangoes will soon finish.
Right.
So if you give it away, that's a charity. That's not a business. There's a difference between a charity and a business.
Okay.
Because if you give it away, you will not have enough money to buy a next batch of mangoes. So business and charity is two different things. Mm-hmm. Yeah, business and charity. But we're saying in the practice of it, in the execution of the business, if the principle is that if you have persons with different values and standard, you're yoked together, there'll be confusion, because when you say no, we can do that, the person say, "Watching that," because that's confusion.
Yeah.
Your ethical and moral values is what guide your business practice.
Good.
You see, and if you link with someone who don't care about that, that's confusion.
Okay.
They figure that you're wasting time,
mm-hmm.
because everybody else is doing that, and if you don't do that, you're wasting time. So we have to be careful. That's what the Apostle Paul is saying: don't yoke yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Yoke, you are bound to it. And then if you're bound to it, then it's going to be problematic, be it in a relationship, mm-hmm. as relates to marriage relationship, a business relationship, or other kinds of relationship where, create this bond, meaning you have a, you can't just easily drop off, Yoke means you can't just say, okay, mm-hmm. things I'm gone. No. You're tied yourself, legally and otherwise.
All right. Look at question there, Pastor. Donna Bacon is asking, can I rent my home to an unbeliever? They want to be practical about it. They say they love Pastor because Pastor is practical. So they drop a practical question inside it. Can I rent my home to an unbeliever?
And the simple and easy answer is yes, why not? of course, you remember.
That's a business.
Yeah, no, you're not in a business. There's a business arrangement.
Right.
But you're not bound to that. You rent your home to an unbeliever. You'll have to, the person's living, the unbeliever is a human being.
Mm-hmm.
The person lives there. And you're here in an apartment maybe, or you're somewhere else and your house is free. And living arrangement. The person lives there. The person So you put some clauses in place, what you want in your property, what you don't want, what have you. You put that in place. But obviously, you know it's an unbeliever. Mm-hmm. So meaning, when Sabbath comes, the person not going to church, the person is in your home. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong in that. There's nothing wrong in that. The person is not going to church that day. You're not renting about going to church. You're renting for someone. Mm-hmm. But you want to put some clauses in place. Minus that. What music you play, what, you know, a number of mm-hmm. other things that cause respect for your property, mm-hmm. if you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So that's a different arrangement. You know, that's a rental agreement mm-hmm. That you give to someone. You could rent your home for a member and the member decides, a believer, you know, and decides Saturday they're staying home, they're not going to church. You know, if you understand, they're staying home, they're not going to church. So you're not renting the building for the person who goes to church, if you understand what I'm saying. You rent it for someone who is utilizing it for a dwelling place. They want a place to live, you know.
Mm. Okay. All right, let's go to yet another question. Let's speak about, coming back to the question of marriage, should a committed Christian from we have a religion mentioned here. Let's say, from the Baptist Church, marry a committed SDA Christian. So we're asking, should there be the marrying of persons from two different denominations, religious persuasions? I mean, of course.
I want to hear Pastor Bonian.
And the church manual has guidance and so forth. So, Pastor, that's an easy one.
Well, what I can say is that the doctrines are different. The beliefs are different,
okay.
Right? As if you put it in the question, put Seventh-day Adventists. Mm-hmm. If I answer it in this line, I would say that Seventh-day Adventists believe in the doctrines are different than a Baptist. So if you two person get married and they believe the different things, they'll have chaos in the house.
Mm-hmm.
So I think even though the person is a believer, but yet they share the values and so are different, then that will create some problem within the church. I can give a quotation from the Spirit of Prophecy. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. Can I read a quotation for us? Adventist Home, page 63, paragraph 1. Never should God's people venture upon forbidden grounds. Marriage between believers and unbelievers is forbidden by God, but too often the unconverted heart follows its own desires, and marriage unsanctified by God are formed. Because of this, men and women are without hope and without God in the world. Their noble aspirations are dead, but the chain of circumstances, they are held in Satan's net. Those who are ruled by passion and impulse will have a bitter harvest to reap in this life, and the course may result in the loss of their souls. So basically, what she's saying here is that in some cases, some people they married with they started out well. They started out well. This person will say, look, I don't have a problem joining your faith. And then when they get married and they yoke together, realize that the person's saying, look, I only say this to get you. Now I get you, I don't have to do those things. So we have to be very careful when we're doing that. I think Christians should not marry persons who are from the different denomination. As a pastor, if they come to the pastor, same the Adventist pastor to do it, the manual stated that the pastor should not do it. Should not baptize and marry these two persons. So I just want to share that with us.
Okay. Yeah, pastor, you know, that is something that is always out there with some of our brethren. You see, we have the tendency, we want to do what we want to do. Mm-hmm. And we want God to bless it. We want to do what we want to do. But at the same time, we want God to bless it. But it doesn't work like that. Okay. God will bless what he wants to bless. Okay. God will not bless what I want to bless. Mm-hmm. You see? So the word of God is clear. Do not yoke yourself with unbelievers. Yes, the Apostle Paul, when he said he wasn't referring to Adventists and Baptists because there was no such existence. Mm-hmm. So the principle has to be applied. So the believer, when someone, who's a believer? You want to marry? So they ask you all this question. Who's a believer? Okay. So a Baptist is a believer in Christ. An Adventist is a believer in Christ, of course. Well, that's the commonality in the doctrine.
Okay.
Well, so it's easy to take the common aspect. A Baptist believe that, when Jesus comes, Jesus will come someday, the second coming of Christ, and we're going to heaven. The Adventists believe that commonality in Christ. So we always pick those that are the common. But then those that differentiate us, we leave that out. It's bound to be, pastor, in my short few years the Lord has given me. Even my pastoral ministry as a marriage officer. I've seen it over and over. Mm-hmm. There are some people that are bright and they want to disprove God.
Okay.
You know, so they will do it nonetheless. Mm-hmm. But the Bible already said, don't do it. And of course, there are persons who have done it. God's mercies, because God is a merciful God. And things turn around. The spouse, you know, come over and what have you. Mm-hmm. But the contention is great.
Yeah, true.
You see, the contention is great. You started off by your honey, you're there, and you're locked together. But then Sabbath, you want to go to worship the Lord. No, that's not an issue. A person goes Sunday. Eventually, you start pulling apart because it's just different. Mm-hmm. We agree on many things doctrinally. But we differ on maybe one or two things. But the difference is great. You see, that's the devil's trap. We agree on so many things, okay? But the difference is just these two things. But it's significant, you see? Okay. So when you are joined together, it doesn't provide harmony. You have to always try to persuade, two believers, two separate vendors. Mm-hmm. And you still have to persuade.
All right.
Because some have Holy Ghost and some don't have Holy Ghost. No, two people, they're married, they're two Adventists.
Talk to me.
But one genuine, the other is a hypocrite. Okay. You see? So you still have to persuade that one to do what is right, and they still ask you why you shouldn't drink Coke or what have you. You know, you're Adventist in name, but the practice is different. And if the practice is different, someone asked a question, and I think I answered, can you be in the same faith and be unequally yoked? Of course. Because you could have a genuine person and one is, two named seven Adventists. Mm-hmm. But what do they believe? When you start going to doctrine, they say, I ain't believe that. I ain't believe the Bible saying that. Mm-hmm. Well, they're in the same religion. Mm-hmm. But their belief is different. I ain't see nothing wrong if I eat that. Your belief, your reasoning will be impacted by your belief. Mm-hmm. So, yes, you could be in the same religion. Yes? And still be unequally yoked because it's based upon what you believe.
Okay.
You don't believe it. Yes, your name Seventh Adventist, but you don't believe the same thing.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes? Because your practice is different. Mm-hmm. You answer to the same vows, yes, but your practice is different. Mm-hmm. And that happens a lot. Okay. Someone asked Pastor, something, and we hear it all the time. Someone, what? Yeah. I made a covenant, mm-hmm. but not, well, a comment not too long.
Okay.
I'm in the church. Mm-hmm. I have somebody.
He's worldly.
He's worldly.
Starts going to church and want to get baptized. Should I marry him?
Yes.
I am a Christian.
Yeah, the problem is that some of us think we are the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. No, we think we can convert people.
All right.
It's only the Holy Ghost to convert people. I tell people all the time, the gospel, we have the gospel and it's a progressive gospel. We need to present the gospel so the persons come. Mm-hmm. So we need to do that. So when you present the gospel, you're a young lady and you present the gospel in a Bible study, in a friendship, and you see that person coming to, let them come to Jesus. Mm-hmm. But sometimes the person on the way to coming to Jesus, we start attracting them and we want them to come to us.
You have ulterior motives.
It doesn't matter if you are, what I'm saying, let the person go to Jesus. Because if the person is in Jesus, mm-hmm. and they can easily come to you.
Okay.
Because they come to Jesus. Mm-hmm. But sometimes we the person on the road to Jesus, but we sidetrack them to have them to come to us. It's going to be a problem. Okay. They're not grounded. Mm-hmm. They must get to Jesus. And when they get to Jesus, then it's easy to come across. So there's no problem you liking someone who's not yet fully in the faith. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but hold it there. Hold it. You hold it just the likability. Mm-hmm. And let them go to Jesus.
Okay. So the baptism shouldn't be because of you, but because of Christ.
Let them find Jesus. Yes. Oh. You see, if they find Jesus, it's going to be okay. Mm-hmm. When it is that they have not found Jesus, mm-hmm. The problems are multiplied. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Very nice. Well, we have yet another question. I believe there are some questions here that we would have alluded to, we would have answered as we went along in terms of that question with the PhD marriage and that person that is of a humble background, so on. So I don't think we need to delve into that again, except you think you want to share deeper on it. And even that area, unequally yoked, even within the faith, same faith body. So we already spoke about that.
Yes, naturally. I think we covered that. And just to say the incompatibility thing, mm-hmm. As I said earlier at the very beginning, you can have a doctor mm-hmm. who marries, a male or female, it doesn't matter, PhD, mm-hmm. and married a simple person, a gardener, and whatnot. That, if you satisfy with that, that's fine. Mm-hmm. And that, there's nothing wrong in that. Okay. Because that person could be a very simple person, mm-hmm. But is well read.
Okay.
That's the thing about relationship is about conversation and being able to, it's like ability, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not about what you have, not the paper you have in your hand. Mm-hmm. So sometimes we fool ourselves thinking, well, if I'm a doctor, I'm a doctor, it'll work. Not necessarily. No, you're just two pig heads just fighting each other. It could be, you know. I mean, very frank. Sometimes that's what it is. It's not that it's like you want it if they have understanding at all. But you can have someone very educated and marry someone, you know, a simple person, fashion designer, a simple person. Mm-hmm. But the fact is that they have good understanding and good, they can communicate properly, yes? And therefore, the person who's has a PhD or what have you, let's suppose the male, the lady can dress. She's a simple person. Mm-hmm. She, you know, she's just a store clerk or what have you. Mm-hmm. She can dress well so that there's no problem when it's time to go out. Would my wife look good? No, she has it covered. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she has it covered. So it doesn't mean that, okay, well, she doesn't have a first degree, she doesn't know how to dress. No, people have first degree and don't know how to dress. So I'm saying it has a lot to do with ability to communicate. Okay. Because learning is not about, you don't go to a university to learn only. Learning is about, you read books, you see things, so learning is your ability to learn and to converse has a lot to do with your view and stance in life. Okay. It's not only relegated to, did I attend university or didn't I attend university?
There's some people PhD and they can't cook.
Okay.
And they're not organized and so on. Yes, and so all those things can be taken into consideration. And plus, if the person is at a higher level than you, they could help the other person to reach up to the level. They can teach each other and so on. I see it happen. A lot of relationships in these cases survive, you know, even though the person is a little more educated than them. They survive over the times. Mm-hmm. But there are relationships where people, they're on the same level and, you know, surviving. You understand? And as Pastor alluded to, is a mutual understanding between the two persons can keep them together and so on. So that's important there.
So we shouldn't have a looking down.
That's correct.
On the other individual. If that starts happening, then it's going to create a problem
in
the relationship. There would be some disturbance and dissonance. All right, at this time, let us pause and take a special item as we internalize what we would have discussed and the comments that were shared. Sure.
You're fighting. Does it seem like the storm just won't break? Is there a mountain in front of you that doubt says will never move? And you wonder, will God make a way? Well, tell me a time he's not been faithful. Tell me your morning is mercy's worth new. Tell me a moment he wasn't able to carry you through. Tell me a day he was less than almighty, when he could not roll back the tide. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find
there was never a time.
So be strong in the Lord and remember to take hold of faith and stand firm. Oh, you can be confident, the Lord keeps his promises. If you doubt it, then read through his word.
Well, tell me a time he's not been faithful. Tell me a morning his mercy's worth you. Tell me a moment he wasn't able carry you through. Tell me a day he was less than almighty, when he could not
not roll back the time. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find there was never a time.
Oh, he can work miracles to the impossible. If you don't believe it, just go on and try.
Tell me your morning, his mercy's worth you. Tell me your moment, he wasn't able. Not roll back the tide. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find there was never a day he was less than almighty. When he could not roll back the tide. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find.
We are back with Pastor's Corner after the majestic voices. I'm sure the voices were indeed majestic. And if you miss the first few minutes, you missed a lot. We have our president with us, and he's laid out some practical comments as it pertains to being unequally yoked. And we also have Pastor Dwight Bowen, who joined us. And so we are having a fruitful, wholesome discussion as pertains to being unequally yoked. And there are some persons who are pushing in some questions on the chat, and we appreciate that. We like that. And we see again somebody asking about renting your property to a couple that's not married, and then what about persons that are smoking and so on. So let's ask the president to just give a brief comment on that as we move ahead.
Yes, Pastor, I think these are relevant questions, not the topic today.
Okay.
I think I want to promise you all that Pastor's Corner will one day address this issue in its entirety, substantially. Okay. Mm-hmm. But just to say, those things has a lot to do with agreements, what agreements you make. Mm-hmm. You see, if you're a Christian and you have certain values, you know, if you ask me, if I don't have any place to rent, but if I have somewhere to rent, would I rent it for persons who smoke and what have you? No, I'll put that in the agreement. Mm-hmm. You know, because it's not my values and I don't want it. If you want to smoke, you smoke wherever else, but not my property. And okay, that can, I mean, it can easily be handled. Mm-hmm. I cannot manipulate persons' lives, but I have a property and I would want, what do I want on the property? Like some persons rent for you and they say, no animals. So you have to leave your dog, or, you know, that kind of thing. It's the same principle. You put what you want. But that these are substantial topics, areas that needs to be addressed in its entirety. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Very nice. How does the Bible guide believers in choosing life partners to ensure they are not unequally yoked? And what are the potential consequences of disregarding this guidance? So what are the guidance given, and what are the consequences if you do not adhere to those biblical guidelines?
Hey, Pastor, time is running away, but I just like to say that, you know, the Bible, well, of course, we read it in the Apostle Paul said, but when we look at the Old Testament, Abraham was an old man, Genesis chapter 24, mm-hmm. and well stricken in age, his son Isaac is not 19 or 18, mm-hmm. you know, is a full grown young man, and he wants a wife for his son before he dies. He wants to make sure that his son follows the precepts. Now, why is Abraham going at length? So he calls his eldest servant, Eliezer, mm-hmm. and asks Eliezer to rest his hand upon his thigh and pledge that he would, Eliezer, mm-hmm. find a wife. He will not go to the heathens. He will not go to the Hittites, mm-hmm. the Jebusites,
and find a wife for his son Isaac. Mm-hmm. And that's Genesis chapter 24. And Eliezer says, well, suppose I go on and you know, I get a wife, but she doesn't want to come. So that Isaac has to now go. Abraham was sharp. Abraham said, no. Please pledge to me that you're not going to find a lady and then have to take my son. She must come. Because you see, the God I serve is not that he's not over there, mm-hmm. but the practice is not over there. Okay. And therefore, she has to be among my people, mm-hmm. but also she has to come right. to be influenced positively. So the Bible has guide. Yes, and of course, we know the story. Eliezer went and you know, and sorry, Rebecca and all the stuff. But Abraham was very concerned mm-hmm. that as his, you know, his age and he was going down, that his son Isaac got a godly lady mm-hmm. to marry. The Bible is very clear on this matter.
Okay. Yeah, I had the same point that Pastor had.
Right.
Married from the same religious faith and similar values. Mm-hmm. And you speak about Abraham. Value parental responsibility and support. Godly parents must help the sons and daughter to choose the choice of a life partner. And not to tell them, don't choose this or not. Advise them mm-hmm. and work together. So put it before God in prayer. Mm-hmm. You have to keep on praying. And the Spirit of Ellen White said, if men and women are in the habit of praying twice a day before contemplating marriage, they should pray four times a day mm-hmm. when such a step is anticipated.
Okay.
Choose a matured partner. Though marriage is not for children. So you have to choose a macho partner who understands and so on. I think Pastor will allude on that.
Yeah, but even as you know, as we said further, no, Abraham uh-huh. got this, got Isaac. Mm. Well, Eliezer got this godly lady. Mm. Isaac then had two children, mm-hmm. Jacob and Esau. Mm-hmm. And Esau went and chose two wives, Judith and another one. From the Hittites, you ask what the consequences? Bitter consequences, different from Jacob.
Correct.
Yes? Mm-hmm. So, yes, there are consequences. I'm saying sometimes it works because much prayer, much sweat, sometimes it you pull through. Mm-hmm. God is still merciful. But the bitter consequences, I'm saying even Pastor Lance, when someone, no offense, ladies, I have a wife married for 25, almost in 2 months with 25 years.
All right.
But even when you have a godly lady mm-hmm. or a godly partner, a godly husband, it's much prayer and tears. Because Rebecca was godly. But Rebecca, she was chosen pastor. She was handpicked. Mm-hmm. And she helped Jacob deceive Isaac in his old age. Oh, imagine if she wasn't godly. Mm-hmm. Even when you're godly, you still succumb to sin. Imagine when you have a partner who's not godly.
All right.
I ain't saying more.
All right, let's go on and let me ask what it pertains to one denomination joining with another denomination to hold some activity or program, be it a cancer walk or be it a health walk or be it a drug march in the community. Should denominations join together to hold programs?
And I would say, you say joined and okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we agree to, which is different from yoke, you see? Mm-hmm. Yoke is like a legal bond. You have like marriage, like business, you know? But of course, even in religion, you have to be careful because, the good of the society, anti-drug march, let's move together and you know, the government decides for some reasons to enact laws that male, you know, two females can get married and another denomination said, no, we're against that. And we join together and march against that. Oh, that's fine. That's perfect. Unity. Okay. But there are some things, there can be no unity on it.
Okay.
No, there are some doctrinal areas that can be no unity. So, yes, you should join wherever it's necessary and feasible. Mm-hmm. But and that's why, too, we're not, for example, the Conference of Churches, we have observer status.
Okay.
We can't be a member because to be a member, you give up actually. That's what it really means. You give up your doctrinal issues mm-hmm. Or peculiarities and are willing to join together. And the Seventh-day Adventist Church can't do that. So we can participate wherever we are allowed to participate.
Okay.
But we can't give up our doctrinal issues. It's who we are.
It's foundational.
Yes, it's foundational. Mm-hmm. It's who we are. So we can't give it up. But if you will understand and you say, well, let's, for the sake of Christianity, for the sake of, you know, the gospel, let's share in this program, great. But there are some limitations. There are some space in them you can't go further because of the doctrinal collision. You know, and it's problematic.
All right, very nice. Yes. And our final question for today, in the context of relationships, there are some young persons who say that there is not enough partners in the church. We know the whole concept already. And as a result, they go outside of the church. And so the question is, what counsel would you give to such persons? I believe you all would have worked on that area already. But as we close up, just speak to the young people a little bit and give some guidance as we move along. And I'm seeing our president look into the young man, Pastor Dwight Bowen, who was recently married and is still basking in the ambience of the honeymoon mode.
Mercy.
Amen. What I can say is that if you speak in an Adventist context, Adventism is not limited only to a surrounding our church.
Okay.
You may not find it in your church, but it can press out in the wider waters.
Okay.
You may go to St. George's. You understand? You don't find anything. Right. You go to Trinidad and go someplace, but okay, in the Adventist context.
But
you can tell them that.
And you can also go to Guyana.
You can go to Guyana too, yes.
Just checking.
But I was I thought I was the first country you'd have called. Go ahead, Pastor. Go ahead.
Yeah, and pray and trust God. Mm-hmm. You have to do that. You know, God could just pop up somebody from nowhere.
Okay.
You understand? Trust God, pray, and don't give up hope. You will find. And I know that a lot of people have been looking. I was looking a long time.
All right.
But yet God pop up somebody for me. You see? So you have to fish in the wider waters. Don't fish only in the pond in front of you.
Okay.
And swim further out in the ocean.
Just to add, Pastor, you know, this issue of relationship, you're looking. Mm-hmm. God looking for you. So let me say we're looking. Mm-hmm. Is God looking for you?
Amen.
The wise man Solomon says, a man that has friend must show himself friendly. And some of us, we're just foolish with ourselves. We're looking for persons. We set our marks. We set our boundaries, our ideas. We can't even meet our own ideas, but we're looking for persons, the ideas in other persons. Okay. We are very not so friendly. You know, I'm making the points, and let me say, we're looking. Yeah, but it's right there.
Yeah.
But you're looking. Mm-hmm. If you know what I'm saying. So but there should be no reason to disobey God.
Correct.
It's like saying, well, I had a good reason to lie. No, there is no good reason to lie. Lying is always an abomination. So you cannot say, well, the Bible says, do not be unequally yoked. But God will watch that. God, no, I can't find someone, so I'll go in. So, well, you're on your own. God is not with you. You can't. I'm saying, it's like what some of our friends say, you bless spoke. Well, who can bless spoke? I mean, who has that authority to bless spoke?
All right.
Mm-hmm. If you understand what I'm saying, mm-hmm, when God already laid it down, mm-hmm, can someone bless it? It's like, so similarly, God said don't do something, mm-hmm, but we would say, God don't watch that because God realized that. And Pastor, she's nice. you know, that kind of,
right,
you know, it doesn't mean that that person is a good Christian, but the fact is that, mm-hmm, let God do his work in the person. Mm-hmm. When God has accomplished his work in the person, because remember, as I said, the church is an evangelistic church.
Yeah.
When God has accomplished his work, that could very well be, mm-hmm, the person, but let God do it. Don't try to hamstring God and try to work things on your own. It doesn't work.
Right.
It doesn't work.
Okay.
Yeah, let me say this. Sometimes the person, you're passing them every day, but because you know what you're looking for, mm-hmm, it could be the person you're passing there in the street, it could be your wife, you know, in the church.
Okay.
But because you don't have that eyes, the spirit of discernment to discern that the person, so you're moving on to the other person and keep on searching. And some people, they reach 50, 60 years and they're still looking. The time already passed them. You understand? Because they passed the person that God had for them and be looking for something different.
You're so passing for 50 years.
Mercy.
Well, we give God thanks and praise for the discussion that we had today, as pertains to being unequally yoked, that we pray by God's grace that the guidelines and the commands, the wisdom that was shared would indeed help us so that all those confusion that we may have and dissonance within the mind could have been cleared up. And as the president mentioned, There are some areas that we're going to go back into as we move ahead with Pastor's Corner, so that the challenges that you have, we can continue to deal with them. And we can also encourage you, if you have other areas of interest that you believe should be discussed and you're not hearing it, you can always send in a question or a topic area so that we can look at it and we can bring some clarity to you, because that is the essence of Pastor's Corner, to promulgate the foundational principles of God's Word and what we know from the principles of the Word. And so let us, as the Holy Spirit leads us, to act accordingly and walk in the light as Jesus is in the light. Final word, gentlemen?
Well, I would just say that the Word of God is clear, Pastor. I advise all our viewers and listeners. Of course, it may not apply to you because, you know, maybe senior and you're already married, but share those principles. Never deviate in sharing those principles. Young people always have a reason why they want to do certain things. Mm-hmm. But let's stay with the Word of God. We cannot go wrong while staying with the Word of God.
Yeah, I just want to say that don't force yourself to enter a relationship.
Okay.
As we alluded to, let God work on you. And as God work on you, He will open your mind, give a spirit of discernment, so that you're going to make the right choice. And when you put God first, He will stand up for you and bless you tremendously.
All right. So, Pastor Bowen, just close us off in prayer.
Let us pray. Mighty God, we give you thanks and praise for this opportunity where we can study your word and to be able to edify the viewers, dear God, and those who have been tuning with us today. We pray, Lord Jesus, that they will continue to trust you, those who are already married, that they will continue to put their marriage on the altar so that God will be able to bless it. And those who are contemplating marriage and looking for a partner, help them, O God, and give them the assurance that hope is available for them. And they just have to put their life in your hands and you will direct them to the right decision. Bless those, O God, who may have made wrong decisions before and they may have got themselves tied up in relationships that are not pleasing to you. Whatever relationship it is, business and likewise and so, we just pray that you deliver them, dear God. And Lord, may you help them to seek you, so that you can lead them into the right path. We thank you. We bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen. So thank you, and God bless you until we meet again.